Since 1974, countries around the world have marked the World Environment Day on June the 5th to encourage awareness and action for the protection of the environment. The United Nations Environment Programme, which is the leading global environmental authority, has designated ecosystem restoration as the theme of this year's World Environment Day. The UN body says ecosystem restoration can take many forms, such as growing trees, greening cities, and changing diets. Here in China, people from home and abroad have been protecting the environment in their own ways. Katalin Sogor, a Hungarian living in Shanghai, co-founded a plogging group called Trash Running in 2018 with Selina Eisenring from Switzerland. Plogging is a combination of jogging and a Swedish word for pickup. The group holds regular running activities in Shanghai and other Chinese cities. Trash runners pick up litter along the way. Since its inception, the idea and activities have drawn a growing number of followers, as trash running is considered by many as positive for the body and for the city environment. Reporter Zhao Beibei spoke to Katalin Sogor. Sogor was first asked why she co-founded the trash running group with her friend Selina Eisenring.
The idea came up to us rather randomly because we were chatting about our running passion. It actually Chinese New Year of 2018. And we just thought that instead of talking, we could actually do something about it actively. So we were just like kind of thinking out loud, like why not picking up trash on the run? Because we can combine, have a good time together, plus do our part on helping to tackle the waste pollution problem. It's actually very simple if you think about it, because anyone can do it. It's very nice to see that how many other people in other parts of the world are doing the same. As we started, we thought we could just organize runs in the city first and invite our friends and anybody basically who's interested, and then have a good, fun, meaningful workout together and pick up trash on the run. The good thing about it is that we can change things in our environment, like we can actually pick up trash and we can make it cleaner and more beautiful. And since we had the first run in March in 2018, we believe that we can have a good time, a healthy body and a clean environment while doing what we do. What we love, and that's running.
According to your statistics, You've run more than 21,000 kilometers in 13 cities at 499 events, with more than 3,400 new members joining your community in 2020. So who make up the trash running group?
Back in time, we started very small by just, you know, creating a WeChat group and adding people we knew and posted our first event just like that. But since then, we continued organizing more runs on a regular basis, and then we're having more people joining our team every day. So we have members from a very, very diverse group of people from a variety of ages, professions, and backgrounds. But most of our runners are local Chinese, young professionals, people who want to do something not only for themselves or for their own health and fitness, but also for the health of the environment.
So how did you promote your activity in so many cities?
Actually, thanks to reports like this one right now and our active community, we often get approached to start a new group in their city. Also great to see, you know, businesses and various brands turning their interest towards fitness and sustainability. And that helps us to share our mission to a wider group of people. We are actually pretty active on social media, and the posts by our trash runners are the main drive behind the spread of this movement. It is also a challenge, however, for many of them to keep consistent and push through the challenges over time.
How many runners are there in the group all together?
Since we had the mini program, we have actually like actual data of how many people joining, because before that, we were just kind of using the WeChat group for our events. So at the moment, we have over 5,000 members, 5,100, and we are in like all these cities across China through the subgroups.
How many participants are there in the group's largest ever run?
Each time on a regular run, we have about 20 to 30 runners. We also think it's like people in one group that could, you know, run across in a city at night without, you know, any major accident risk. The largest event we had by date is called Line 4thon. It's a marathon distance trash running challenge along the metro Line 4 in Shanghai. And for the year 2, we also organized a sister event in Xinjiang in Shanxi. and that one went through a loop course while picking up trash in groups. We had over 500 people joining to that one. Also, we have an annual beach cleanup we hold in the shores of Shanghai. That one is also over 400 people. These two are our bigger events.
How many runners were there at first?
At the very first event, we had maybe 12 or 13 people.
You are a very big group right now.
Yeah, it took us a long time, and then it's also a teamwork. If you think about it, it's all like kind of a weird, crazy thing to do because everyone does it in their free time and everyone is a volunteer.
Are there any foreigners?
Very few. We are turning into more like a local Chinese group, which was actually our intention from the beginning. Because even though we are foreigners, we thought that while we are in China, everyone is Chinese and then we want to do something for this country. It's actually really interesting to see the group changing, evolving in this direction.
Right.
Definitely a good thing.
What's the usual schedule of trash running? What do you usually do?
We usually meet at the evenings after work because our events are run by volunteers and it fits everyone's schedule better to organize a night run. So we meet about 7 p.m. We have a basic introduction and or maybe some games if there are many newbies joining. And then we do a warm-up, group pictures, and then we do a trash run. The regular run is 6 kilometers. And then after that, we return to the start for social time or for snacks or drinks, and depending on everyone's time and mood. So the route is planned by the team leaders, but the distance remains about the same. And then it takes about an hour to complete.
Are there any special activities besides the regular running?
So once in every 1 or 2 months, we organize a trail or beach cleanup into the nearby areas. And aside those, we keep main events, like special events, such as their Earth Day or Environment Day or Christmas, to mention a few. And the annual big events are the anniversary party in March and the line foursome, which I mentioned before, in September.
What are the reactions of passersby? You know, lots of people will see you running and picking up trash.
Majority of the people they support, they give us thumbs up, or they tell us "Yayo" or "Dian Zan." Or, you know, they're very positive about it, or they thank us even. And some of the runners actually we picked up on a trash run. So they saw us and that they approached, they asked what we're doing, and then, you know, next time they joined themselves. Very positive.
Mm. Will you get new members this way?
Very few, but yes, we do, actually.
What is the appeal of trash running? Is plogging really a good way to socialize and to know the city a bit more?
I think what's cool about trash running is that it attracts people with very different backgrounds. It's not just only the runners or the fitness lovers or like the crazy environmentalists. And we also focuses on the impact we make to collect trash, but also to let others see and realize what's wrong about having so much waste. And of course, there are some like the curious people, you know, the ones socialize even just to practice their English or practice their Chinese. But everyone faces the overall problem and the issue we're trying to tackle. It's the waste in our environment. I think the other angle is the difference we make. It might be strange to see a single person running around, but as soon as there is a big group of these so-called crazy people, the whole activity becomes more like an attraction, a cool thing to do even. I think like just the act of bending our knees, lower ourselves to pick up trash is very important. It's very humbling in a world where people, you know, everyone's really full of themselves and very busy. And then it's very humbling to experience such acts on a regular basis. I also myself joined the running community when I moved to Shanghai, and it really changed my life in many ways.
In what way?
One way is, as you said, like to get to know a city, because you're running, you get lost or you turn at the wrong corner and then you find an entirely new side of it, especially in big cities like Shanghai. There is so much difference in between the different parts of town. The other aspect is how you make friends. You meet people from very, very different backgrounds, but they do share the same values or they have the same hobby, for example, running, but then they're very different and then it gets you to diversity. And then you initiate things like trash running, you know? And then it turns out to be a cool thing to do.
In your opinion, how to fit into our new city? Trash running might be a good way, and any other good idea?
I definitely think that like joining a community of people is a good way. It could be trash running or it could be like fitness, but as long as it's a community, to me at least, it's very helpful because I like to connect with people, and I think it's a very nice way.
So anyone or any story that impressed you most in the trash running group?
I love to see how the people in trash running grow and transform, both in the athletic and in the environment. There are many of the runners who could barely complete 5 kilometers and now signing up for marathon. And also, I myself, I'm one of those who learned a good deal about how important it is to be more responsible environmentally. We've been running these streets for over 3 years now, and every week the trash is still there. You're getting more people joining, but there's still enough trash for everyone. We also got to start thinking about how to reduce the waste at the source.
Are there any challenges for you to organize trash running?
Well, sometimes people are skeptical. If you think about it, like what we do is something like more like a drop in the ocean. It's more about letting the people see and maybe think next time before littering. But we can also measure success not in the number of collected trash bags, but in the small changes in one's lifestyle, like swapping single-use plastic or learning about the climate issues or initiating actions which eventually lead to changes. It's a long way. But I think right now in China, it's very exciting and very empowering to see that a lot of things are changing and happening here. And it's very great to take part as a community here. But to be more exact, actually the biggest challenges in trash running are the running conditions. There are heavy rain.
Yeah, but we can do little about that part.
Yes.
All we can do is to reduce trash and do our best to keep environment clean.
Yes, exactly.
So I know that you are living a green and minimal waste lifestyle. Can you elaborate?
It's a process, and there is a lot to learn along the way. To reduce the amount of waste I create, I rarely buy bottled water. I have my own textile bags for buying vegetables and fruits. I really love growing plants. I also joined a vegan challenge earlier this year. Even though I'm not a strict vegan anymore, I still rarely try to reduce the animal products in my diet. I think at the end of the day, small things matter. Like from the consumer point of view, sort the trash or use public transport or buy, don't waste food, pick up trash. These are the powerful tools in our hands, each of us can use every day.
Mm. In 2019, Shanghai entered a new era of compulsory garbage sorting. What kind of trash do you usually get when you do the trash running?
Maybe 1/4, like 20 to 30% of what we collect is recyclable. Mainly plastic and a lot of cigarette butts. I have to say that our goal is to run while picking up trash. Well, we contribute to the environment, but we are not the street cleaners. So we don't, leave entirely 100% clean streets behind us. We want to raise awareness and then to show people that it actually possible to make change. Since 2019, since Shanghai started a garbage sorting policy, it definitely helped to raise awareness of the pollution issue. Maybe it just gives the first step on dealing with the waste we produce every day. As the policy came into effect, we educated ourselves in our group, including the knowledge on the, what, how, why of the waste sorting. We kept in mind that ultimate goal is still to reduce and not to recycle the waste. But because of the policy, we also had a wave of newcomers interested in the trash run. It's definitely a big boost for us.
How is it going with the garbage recycling in Shanghai?
It is actually became part of everyday life. It's a norm. And then, our first few months were strange for everyone. But now everyone just knows what are the 4 categories. It just became a habit, which I think is a very, very good thing. It's a good start.
Have you found any professional company that can make good use of the trash you sorted out?
Well, the trash we collect during the rounds is very low quality and definitely less quantity that could be used for industrial recycling or upcycling even. Well, we've cooperated with companies to reuse waste, but it's not always exactly the piece of trash we pick up on the street for these infrastructural reasons. Yes, we've had before finisher medals for our event. Made from recycled bottle caps, the plastic bottle caps, or also we have t-shirts made of recycled plastic.
Now let's take a short break. Then when we come back, Sogor will share with us her observations about life in China. Stay tuned.
You've been listening to Footprints.
Now let's continue our interview with Katalin Sogor, an environmentalist based in Shanghai.
What do you think of the urban and suburban environment in China? Because I know you lived in Shanghai and you went to some other places.
You see in China that there are huge differences in lifestyle in urban and suburban environments. Because change is happening really fast and then people learn about new trends like eco-friendliness. It has to be also more convenient and has to be trendy for the big crowds of so different people like coming from different backgrounds. But I think that the approach has to be in different ways because Chinese people are very sociable, so that doing something together as a pack is much more important than in the West when people focus more on things doing by themselves even. So at Threshoning, we try to create a community that is also about having a good time together. It's a good opportunity to exchange ideas and meet people and then make them talk because they come from very different environments and then they can have valuable stories to share and learn from each other. I think that's like one way of bridging the difference between the very, very different lifestyles.
You believe from knowing comes caring and from caring comes change. In the past few years, did you find any surprising changes?
I see that not only individuals, but companies and brands, they also pay a lot more attention to their actions. And then they learn about terms like, you know, carbon footprint or reduced CO2 production. And then these things that make people look into changing the old ways. We also try to support simple small actions like what I mentioned before, like refusing single-use plastics or choosing renewable materials that can be done. So I think those are the main trends that has to be, you know, emphasized later on to make people care more. Because once you know about something, you naturally start caring about it. You know, follow the news and then you read and then you share and exchange ideas about it. And then at that point, you are ready to make changes in your lifestyle, even though not always convenient. Living a more environmentally friendly life is not always convenient, not always cheaper. But then you're willing to sacrifice some of those small things in your life and comfort because you see that something important, you care about it because you learned before that something that matters, something that affects our future for many, many years to come.
How do you like your life in Shanghai?
It's always busy. I never really get bored here. And then I think it's really exciting. You know, it's not just the community, but also, you know, the change or the development, what we see in China every day. But I think it's very exciting to be in a place, take part, and you can experience all these developments, like all these quickly changing environments around us.
You basically live in Shanghai, right? Work and live there. Mm-hmm. So where else did you travel in China?
I really love the Northwest. I've been spending time in Qinghai and Gansu provinces for over almost 3 years now during the summers. It's really wild there, like huge lands and then good food with the most stunning landscape. Overall, I've been very fortunate to join many running races across the country. And that one allows me to get to places I would never even know about, like very, very small cities or hidden villages out of reach. And I enjoy just getting out of Shanghai because it's very interesting and very fulfilling to learn about the less known places of the country. Because it's very, very diverse in terms of natural environment and food and lifestyle. It also balances busy life in Shanghai very well. You can travel a few hours and you are in an entirely different place. And that's one of the things I love about China, actually, that you get to experience that in terms of climate, but also in terms of lifestyle, everyday life and food as well.
You participated in the China International Import Expo. Will you go to the expo this year?
I will see. Hopefully, yes. I'll definitely would like to visit because the first 3 years I joined, I was mainly involved in the food sector because that's my primary field. I work with the food producers. So it was very interesting to see how many green products are out in the market now. And not just the international brands, but also the local companies. And then I would like to see the change.
What do you think of the expo?
I think in my field, like from the food sector, you see all these products becoming more affordable and they becoming trendy. And I think it's definitely the way to go. It's very good to see local companies stepping up and then the competition in this field.
You've been listening to Footprints.
Sogor has lived in China for more than 10 years. She can speak fluent Chinese. Her connection with China dates back to 2009. Then she arrived in Taipei as a university student. Now living in Shanghai, she calls China her second home. Listen to her thoughts about life in Taipei and why she moved to the mainland.
How was your life in Taipei?
First year when I studied just Chinese, it was a lot of fun. It was definitely a culture shock in a good way, very different from what I've seen in Hungary before. And then university was tough because it was a Chinese speaking program and my language skills were not really good at that point. And so I struggled a lot. I studied a lot. I was trying to make a new home for myself over there. It was a long journey.
How long did you stay in Taipei?
Altogether, I stayed 8 years until 2017 when I moved to Shanghai.
So compared with Taipei, is it more difficult to live in Shanghai or more convenient?
It's definitely more challenging because it's a much more competitive environment, more expensive, but it also has a lot more action going on. It's very dynamic. I feel it's less relaxing, but also more rewarding. Shanghai has this great vibe and dynamics, and I find it really exciting to be in this environment. Things are really always happening. I like to keep busy, and here I have the chance to take part and initiate actions and create things that shape our life. You see all these people coming to Shanghai from all over China with hopes to find a new life and make a fortune. Not really a thing you see anywhere else. About Taipei has a really special place in my heart, and I'm connected with the city by all my friends and the people I met there and a lot of memories. But to me, Shanghai was the place where I found the new adventures, and then it still excites me very much.
Why did you move to the Chinese mainland in 2017?
The company I used to work for, they had a Shanghai office, and I was offered an opportunity to join the team here. Since I was looking forward to the change, I decided to move here.
Do you plan to stay here for the next 5 years?
Yes, definitely. Personally, I see myself in China for 5 years for sure. I'm excited to, you know, evolve here as a professional and as a trash runner too. And then for trash running, we have a lot of plans. Maybe one day we can just be a running club on the clean streets without any trash to be picked up. That would be the best.
With that, we conclude this edition of Footprints. For our program producer, Inshou Chi, I'm Lai Mei. Thanks for listening. See you next time. Bye-bye.